Okay, good morning, everybody. So it's 11 o'clock, so I think we should get going. So we start with the second lecture on gravitational waves. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks. Good. So today what we will try to do is first go into the science, and then the second half of today will be about instrumentation. And then tomorrow we look at the future. So first, a brief summary of what we tried to do yesterday. And I tried to convince you that interferometers are well suited to measure the effects of gravitational waves. Gravitational waves can be seen as perturbations in curvature. And the way we did that is we took the metric that is the central object that we talk about. We said you have a background metric, and in this case, I took Minkowski, but you also can take curved background if you want. And then there is these gravitational waves, these perturbations, H alpha beta, which are small. So the Riemann tensor is the thing that governs more or less everything that's going on. It determines the curvature. And gravitational waves are curvature perturbations, so that is clearly important. And it was Pirani who first stated that you can measure these components of the Riemann tensor, for example, you using an interferometer. So this is something that you can derive. It's not so difficult to do. And essentially, if you have a beam splitter here, and you have a mirror here and a mirror here, so it's an interferometer at 90 degrees. Directions are given by these factors, u and v. Here you have your photodetector, where you try to detect your gravitational waves. Then if there is no gravitational wave, then these blue lines here, dashed lines, give you the paths through space. And if you get a gravitational wave, you get perturbations on that. And this is something that is measurable with an interferometer. And you can do this by measuring the wave fronts, for example, that is shown over there. But you also can transfer, if you have these time differences, this into a strain, which is your delta L over L, your relative length changes. So that's equivalent. So that is what we try to do. And relating phases, phase differences, and strain differences is what we will do more today. We also have seen that the first detection was the merger of a binary, two binary black holes. And there are three phases to that. There's the spiral phase that you see over here in this numerical relativity calculation. Then there is the merger. And then at the end, there is a ring down. And these three regimes, theoretically, you can treat the spiral in a post-Newtonian expansion. And the phase of that expansion is known up to seventh order in PN. So people work that out in great detail. The merger, you do a numerical relativity, and the ring down phase, you can describe that in terms of normal modes. And I will say more about that later. If you look at the signal, then the change of frequency is typically governed by a combination of the two masses. It's called the chirp mass. And the maximum frequency that you see here is related to the total mass. So by looking at this maximum frequency here, which is about 150 hertz, that means that the orbital frequency was 75 hertz, because for gravitational waves, if you have this situation, you are half an orbit further, it looks gravitationally the same. So that doubles the frequency. And then the final thing is that the strain that you measure is given by the frequency and the frequency derivative. So you can just look at the plot, and it falls off with 1 over r. So you measure an amplitude. And that means that just by looking at the plot and at the frequencies and the frequency derivative and the amount of amplitude that you measure, you know the distance of the source. And that is something that you can use if you want to do cosmology. So this is the signal of the first detection, where we flipped the sign of one of the interferometers, because they are oriented like this. So we flipped them, And we took the travel time of the gravitational wave into account, which is 7 milliseconds. So we shifted that, and you see that they are on top of each other. And if you are further away, then you have noise. Noise is non-stationary, it's non-Gaussian. You have to be very careful about how you treat all of that. The size of the displacement is shown over here, where a proton radius is in the order of a femtometer. So these are small displacements. So a bit about the science. So the first event, we can do a parameter estimation. So you, the way we do the detection is we have in total 4 different analysis groups. But for these events, there is a burst group, and there's what we call a CBC group, that is a coalescent of a compact binary coalescence. And so the CBC group uses templates that are calibrated on solutions of the Einstein equations, but the burst group doesn't use any assumptions. So the burst group is looking at coherent strength between signals in interferometers, and then try to make a wavelet description of the signal that you see there. And the burst group was actually the group that found the first event, and not the CBC. Then if you make the do the analysis later on, then the CBC group got better precision on the parameters. But of course, there is the assumption that things are calibrated on numerical relativity. And then you can use different waveforms for that description. So you can use effective on-body waveforms or other waveforms, and it depends a bit on how you treat spins in the cases where you can get a full description taking the fully spinning black holes into account, or that you make assumptions there. Anyway, so we extract masses of 29 and 36 solar masses with these error bars for that first event. We can measure the mass in the final state, that is 62 solar masses. So 3 solar masses were missing, and that is then converted into gravitational waves. The peak power, because the event was very short, so the peak power was the conversion of 200 solar masses per second. And so these are very, very powerful events, but you only can see them in gravitational waves. There's no atom there to give you any electromagnetic signal or anything else. The distance is given over here, so 410 megaparsec, but you see with huge error bars, about plus or minus 40% error bar. And I will come back to that later. The redshift is 0.09, say 0.1, so it's very close. So so we say it's 1.3 billion light years away. That sounds like a lot, but essentially it's next door. It's a redshift of 0.1. So what we also have difficulty is making statements about the spins in the initial state. We can say that the spin in the final state is typically around this 0.67. We see that this in most events. And this is the final state. So there you see the mass, the 62 solar masses, and you see the spin in the final state. In natural units. So if you look at the Kerr metric, the maximum that you could get is 1. Would be great if experimentally you measure something that's higher than 1. Would have lots of implications like naked singularities and things like that. But we didn't see it. Here is the distance, the luminosity distance, versus the inclination. And what is so this explains why it's so difficult with only the LIGO detectors to get a good measure of the distance. And it has to do with if you have the plane where the two things are orbiting, and you look edge on at that plane, the only thing that you will detect is plus polarization of gravitational waves, only this one. That is what will come at you. If, on the other hand, the plane is oriented like this, so you look face on and it's orbiting like that, you will get circular polarization. So you will get a combination of plus and cross polarization states. And the thing is, you cannot disentangle. You don't know. So if you don't know, and there is a factor of 2 difference in the amplitude, then you get this degeneracy that immediately you don't know the distance, because you use the amplitude to determine the distance. So you would like to know the polarization components, because then you can decompose that, and then you can determine the distance more precise. But to do that, you need a detector which is oriented at, let's say, 45 degrees. with respect to these detectors. And that is what Virgo is essentially doing. Here you see the component spins. And so we have, we take the orbital angular momentum vector, and then we take the spins of the black holes and we project them on the orbital. That is this chi effective over here. And what you see is that it's beautifully around zero. And that means we don't see any component of the spins of these black holes along the orbital momentum. And which you might find surprising if you're an astrophysicist, because if you believe that you first had stars in a binary system orbiting and they would become black holes then and they would come close together, you would think that probably everything would be aligned in spin. And, but it's not what we see. So the other thing that could be is that maybe they are anti-aligned. We don't know, we have no idea. Or that they are perpendicular to the orbital angular momentum and that they would precess around it. Now, so we can try to get a handle on the perpendicular part, so the precessing part, but in green you see the prior and then black the posterior. You see we have no sensitivity right now for that. And in order to get spin precession effects, you need to measure a very long waveform to get amplitude modulations and to get frequency modulations in order to extract precession effects. But here we only had like four orbits or eight oscillations, and that was it. So we couldn't extract that. So we cannot say a lot about this. In the first observing run, there was a second event that actually a third one. There was also a trigger in October that in a later analysis we raised to the level of an event. So that means that we believe it is five sigma. We have confidence in that. We didn't have that on the first analysis. We calibrated our strains and cleaned things. Here you see the Boxing Day event, so second Christmas day. And this is a long event, it's 1.5 second. And you wouldn't see the signal in the data anymore. Maybe with some fantasy you can get it here out of this frequency time plot. And, but what we do is a template analysis. So we have all these different templates, millions of them, and we shift them over the data and, in a linear system. This is mathematically the optimal way to pick out a signal. Yeah? And that is what you see over here. So you pick it out, and here is where the template is matching. And you get an SNR of 10, and here you get a signal of a noise of 8, and you combine that. So that is how we determined this event. So that was based on the template matching. Here you see this Boxing Day event. So this is a numerical relativity calculation based on the parameters of that event that is made by the SXS collaboration. And what you see here is that the strain is increasing in magnitude. So the amplitude is going up. And also you see the frequency is increasing. So that's the frequency, and this is the speed of the system. And at the end, what you typically get is that it comes in the last stable orbit, and then it plunges into the black hole. So that is what is happening here above. Now it falls in. And you see the black hole, the horizon is deformed, and then it rings down to the final state. So this event was lighter. We could measure it longer. So the initial masses, 14.5 solar masses, a final mass of 21 solar masses. And you see you get better constraint on this combination of masses that we call the chirp mass. It gets much more precise. But still difficult to get the individual masses with high precision. We need to get, and the distance is about the same as for the first event. And here you see the spin, so the aligned part, chi effective. And you see the distribution here. So these are 90% confidence levels. And it's, it gives some evidence that there is some spin in that, aligned spin in that system. So all these measurements were done by LIGO detectors only. So we are a collaboration, LIGO and Virgo, already since, I think, 2006 or 2007. We have completely integrated data analysis groups, but we have separate instruments. And In August 2017, Virgo was ready to join. And Virgo is a European collaboration. There are eight countries involved, about close to 500 members, but 360 authors, and around 90 institutes. Virgo is growing rapidly. Many groups from particle physics are joining Virgo, and I think it also has to do with something with the intellectual appeal of this science. This is the Virgo detector. It looks similar to the LIGO detector, except that these arms are 3 kilometers long and not 4 kilometers. And then there is a mirror here, which is called the signal recycling mirror, which increases your sensitivity at high frequencies. I will talk more about that later. And Virgo is going to install that next year, and it is already installed in LIGO. So when we joined in 2017, LIGO was already running for quite a while. And I was aware of two detections, the one on January 4th and one in June. So we only joined for 3.5 weeks. So my expectations were not very high when you look at that plot. I was very happy that we got the sensitivity to join the run, but it was not so that I expected many events. Now, that was not the case. In total, in run 1 and 2, we measured 11 events, 10 of them binary black holes and one binary neutron star. That is this one over here. And we published the catalog of these events, so the transient catalog, in December last year. In February, we made all our data public. So the entire data sets of O1 and of O2, I think it's 14 months of data, is publicly available. You can use it. You can use all the tools and try to see if you can find maybe other events. And other groups are doing that, and people are finding events. Okay, so it's there is a lot of science in this. So this is the is a page from that catalog, and in red here are all the events where Virgo contributed. So much for statistics. So it was quite a busy month in August. I don't know why that happened, but fine with me. Also, the binary neutron star was exactly in that month. And what Virgo can contribute especially is if you look at the sky localization. So it was typically this level. So we could contribute to several events quite good sky localization. And especially this was useful for finding the binary neutron star. And still, this is for standards in astronomy, terribly big, and several times the size of the moon on the sky. I think that's 5 square degrees or so. So in the catalog, you find the information on the masses. For example, here you see these 11 events. You see when the masses become smaller, you get a much better handle on the chirp mass. And this is the binary neutron star over here. These are the spins in the final state. So they are all typically like that. And this is the mass range that we covered. That mass range is also interesting because astrophysically, there are some areas where people don't expect black holes to exist with certain masses. So I will go through a selection of the things that I find interesting. So this is the first event that we published with Virgo. So there was the first triple detection. So you see the SNR here in Livingston quite high, and you see this bump over here. I think it's 4.4 in Virgo, and you see the signals in the detectors. So it's again 31 and 25 solar masses. So it's a little bit lighter than the first event, but so 53 solar masses in the final state. So what you now can do if you have detectors which are oriented with respect to each other is you can try to get a handle, for example, on the polarization of gravitational waves that I talked about. And so in general relativity, there are these two polarization states, which are called H plus and H cross. But in general, in general metric theories, there are six polarization states. So there is also, apart from a tensor, there is also vector polarization and scalar polarization. These are the possibilities. And different theories for gravity have different predictions on the existence of these polarization states. So this is interesting to try to analyze that. And then when you think about gravitational waves, that is pure space-time. So when you talk about polarization of gravitational waves, what you are looking at is that you take space-time, and how does space-time deform under gravity? So can it deform in all of these ways? Or is it, as general relativity says, no, it is only possible to deform according to these tensor polarizations. So what we take advantage of is that the detectors have different antenna patterns, so different sensitivities for different sources, type of sources for that. And we can then do an analysis. So that is an independent analysis, an independent test of general relativity, where we either assume that it's pure scalar, pure vector, or pure tensor. And the result is that tensor is favored over vector by about a factor of 200 and over scalar by a factor of 1,000. Of course, what you would like to do is you want to be a bit more democratic and you want to make a mixture and see what would you allow in all of that. So we don't have the precision to do that yet. So we will do that later on. But be aware that general relativity is not democratic. Okay, it's purely tensor. So another thing that you could do is that if you have these black holes that are in spiraling and you measure in the in spiral phase, you measure the masses and the spins, then you can predict based on general relativity what the final mass of the final black hole, what the mass and the spin should be, because it's determined. You have the initial state and then you have your theory, so you can predict that. So here you see the prediction, of course. So this is the prediction of general relativity minus what you see in the experiment, so the deviation from general relativity. And you see for the masses what you predict is consistent with general relativity. We do the analysis in such a way that we can combine the information from different events. It's a Bayesian analysis that allows you to take that information into account. And the same over here for the spin. So this is the mass. Spin plot, and this plus is here if you would have infinite precision and general relativity would be valid, and we are here right now. So that would be like a first test of general relativity. And like the polarizations, you also could consider like a test of general relativity. So no deviation. So the other thing that you can do is you can look at this whole in spiral part over here. So you take these Poisson-Newtonian coefficients, and you look at the data and you try to see how much room do I still have in this description of my waveform if I would, for example, have freedom in each one of these Poisson-Newtonian coefficients. And then what you see, so the deviation from general relativity is again plotted over here. So it's all consistent with general relativity, but you see that items we are already testing are the precision of 10-20%. And this will improve a lot in the future. So we will certainly go to the percent level and the future detectors, we go to the sub per mil level of these kind of tests. And these PN components have different meanings. For example, the 1.5 PN component is a description in GR that if you have gravitational wave and you have curved background spacetime of these black holes, how do they scatter? How do they interfere? So that's the back reaction. You have these spin orbit terms in the interaction, the spin terms. And so the tidal terms are the tidal effects with black holes. The general relativity tells you no, but you can check all of that. But for example, the last one, you have to do at 5 PN. So very high frequency. So this is the kind of analysis that we do, and for the moment we don't see a deviation. If you look at the PN expansion, then this doesn't exist, because this is the limit on dipole radiation, which you also should not have in GR. Then you can do parameterized tests of merger and ring down. But so this is a study that we do, and we constantly keep updating that information. Then you can ask yourself, so in these measurements, are you certain that what you have seen are black holes? Because if you read the literature, you take it all serious, you will see many alternative models that go way beyond general relativity. It's really difficult to accept that all the matter that would go in would end up in a singularity and essentially would disappear from the universe. So there are discussions there. And so how certain are we? Now, this is the best evidence, I think, that we have. So you take a black hole here in the final state, and you excite it. You hit it with a hammer. It will ring like every object in a certain frequency, and also in higher order modes it will ring. And these frequencies will decay down with a certain time constant. Now, for this black hole, so if you go a little bit before it was in its final state, it was a deformed system over here where the two initial black holes have merged. So the merger is happening here. You wait a little bit until you're certain that the complete horizon has formed, and then this black hole will ring down to its final state. So these are these wiggles that you see over here. According to general relativity, that should happen for this system with at around 250 hertz. That should be the dominant frequency, and it should ring down in 4 milliseconds. And what we measure is given over here. So if you take 3 milliseconds after the merger, and you take that part and you do parameter estimation, you find something that is from 230 to, what is it, 260 hertz. And it is from 3 to 9 milliseconds. So that is the evidence that we have. So is this now ironclad evidence that these are the black holes of general relativity? No, I think for a physicist, the answer is no. So I say for a physicist because some people are wondering why I still am doubting that. I would believe it when you also would measure all the higher modes in that system and the decay constant of these higher modes to make entirely sure that indeed this is consistent with GR. So that is what we are aiming at, but I cannot show you that right now. Then there is another thing that could happen. So in many of these black hole mimickers, you have that matter comes in, but it, so either there is no horizon, for example, in a wormhole, you don't have an horizon, or you have like gravistar solutions where you have something that resembles dark energy and the matter is falling in and you get the layer around the horizon. Now, if you would have things like that, so then you would see echoes because you start creating cavities. And even if the distance would be Planck scale distances where it would be outside the horizon, then through general relativity effects, you still would see them, let's say 100 milliseconds after the merger. So we're looking for that. We do analysis to find evidence for these echoes. If you would have found that, you would have heard it about it. But so this will be beautiful evidence if we could find that for alterations of black holes. So summarizing, we are looking at the in-spiral signals, so modifications maybe due to tidal interactions, the ringdown process I talked about, and echoes. And we have analysis groups on all of that. Another thing that you can do is that if you would have quantum gravity, you would have a quantum, that's a graviton. I'm not stating here that the graviton exists, but if the graviton would exist, then we could put a limit on the mass. And the reason is that if it has a mass, a Compton wavelength, then you would get this dispersion relation over here. And that dispersion relation would give you a frequency-dependent speed. Because it's graviton has mass, it cannot go with the speed of light. And you would see that in the 1.5 pm component in your analysis. And you can use that to put a limit on the graviton mass. And what we did is we have a limit right now that if the graviton exists, then the mass is smaller than 5 × 10⁻³ eV. That limit is 10,000 times more stringent than the current limit on the mass of a photon. So this is quite a stringent limit, and the reason that it can be that good has to do with the fact that it would give you a dispersion over this more than a billion years of travel time. So that is there are other limits also, say in the literature, which are even stronger, but they make different assumptions than what we do. Then, if you generalize the dispersion relation, so instead of making a mass term here, you take the momentum to a power alpha, and so what you're doing is you are questioning Lorentz invariance at this moment, then you can look at the phasing of these gravitational waves, and you can put limits on this amplitude of that contribution. So if this is not there, then gravitational waves go with the speed of light. And otherwise, so these limits that we set are given over here. And so you can ask yourself, so why are you doing all of that? Now, the reason is that on these modified theories of gravity, people claim that in some cases that the Lorentz invariance is broken. And we then would get evidence through these kind of analysis. So that is what I wanted to say, black holes, and so then this neutron star. So you know about integral and Fermi, so the gamma ray telescopes in space. And on the 14th of August in 2017, we had the first NICE event in Virgo. 3 days later, we had this one. And so here you see a trigger from Fermi for gamma rays from 50 to 300 keV. And here you see what we saw in one of our detectors. We had 3 detectors operational, but we only saw the result immediately in one of them due to one was from Virgo to Caltech. We had downtime on our computer link, so that delayed the transfer of the data. And there was a glitch in one of the instruments of LIGO. Doesn't want to do it. Anyway, so what you see is the gravitational wave event. So. Here is the merger, and then you see 1.7 seconds later, you see an integral and Fermi, you see the gamma rays. So we knew this, our software immediately gets this event. Our software also looks whether other astronomers are announcing any announcements of observations. So we also knew about the Fermi one, and there was a timescale of minutes that we were aware of that. But then the excitement was there, but then what we had to do is make a sky map and release a sky map so that people could start looking for this event, because you see electromagnetic signal together with this. And also from the length of that signal, we knew this is a binary neutron star already in the analysis. So one of the things that you immediately can do is that given the distance of that event and the fact that it is at the same time within 1.7 seconds, you can say that the speed of light and the speed of gravitational waves are equal to 1 part in 10 to the 15th. So that was a nice statement. The other thing is that both light and gravitational waves are going through gravitational potentials, for example, the potential of the Milky Way. And you can then do a test of the equivalence principle. Do different objects fall in the same way? And they arrive within 1.7 seconds. And so you could put a limit of, say, 1 part of 10 on a million on the equivalence principle. If you expand it to all the galaxies until a distance of 50 megaparsec, you can improve that limit. This fact, by the way, had consequences for several theories of dark energy and dark matter. People are trying to use fields to emulate dark energy and dark matter, and then in that emulation, they get different geodesics for light and for gravitational waves. And we don't see that. So that that was something on the side. The other thing that we could do is do pointing. So we use the arrival times for that, and we use the antenna patterns to do the pointing. And it was very surprising that the signal was so low in Virgo. Well, we knew that we had sensitivity, and it had to do with the fact that it arrived very close to a dark spot in our antenna pattern that we use, of course, for the localization. So this is a nice plot where you see the observatories around the world. And when we got the trigger, it was light in South Africa, where you have many telescopes, and people want to look at the event. And we were wasting time by making this sky map. So apologies for the astronomers that got the sky map too late and then missed the opportunities to do that detection, to find the galaxy. So I can show you that here. So this goes fast. So. And every time, so you see when people are making observations. The first one was in South America, and it was the SWOP collaboration with a 1 meter telescope. They found the source. And then when this was known, about 70 observatories focused in and started collecting data for longer times. So I will skip that. So over the entire spectrum, data have been taken, and this then was the excitement of multi-messenger with gravitational waves. Hubble came into play, so this is the galaxy, and this here is the event, where you see it fading rapidly over a few days. And you can wonder, so why there are so many objects in the center, why is it out there? And that simulation here that should explain that to you is that probably the first events merged over here, but then you get a kick. And the kick kicks that system out of the center. And then after a while, these two systems merge in that location. So when Hubble is involved, NASA is involved, you get beautiful animations. So here you see two neutron stars emitting gravitational waves. They are merging right now, and then you see a flash of gamma rays coming out. And what is staying behind here is what is called the kilonova. So that is a big concentration of neutrons, where you, through rapid capture of neutrons, you can create all of these elements. So it's like a hot oven where you create many of the heavy elements. This is only information from gravitational waves. And if you look just at the signal here and at the time scale, so this goes on, okay? And you see that before it was a fraction of a second that we could detect it for the black holes because it's heavy, but this one is still going on. And so already there you can see it's a different system. Also, since you know the waveform for a long time, you have very good precision on the chirp mass, on the combination of the masses. Then the individual masses is more difficult. If you take the information from astronomy that binary pulsars have a relatively small amount of spin, then you see that the blue gives you then an indication of the masses is about 1.3. And this is maybe 1.4 solar mass, so typical masses for neutron stars. If you relax the your knowledge on the spin, then it becomes much wider. This precision here in the detector frame is 10 minus 4 solar mass on that number. If you go to the source frame, then you have to correct for the redshift, and then you see it's 10 minus 3. You lose an order of magnitude just because of the redshift correction. It's done now. Then the spins. So if we look at spins, then there is this degeneracy in our analysis between the mass ratio and the spin projected on the orbital. And so here is typically what we get. And in general, we don't get a lot of evidence for a spin in that system. And for the perpendicular, we don't, again, have a lot of sensitivity. Neutron stars are incredible objects. If it's mass under the extreme conditions, so all kind of phenomena are going on, or we believe that are going on that you need to describe, obviously QCD. with things like proton superconductivity, superfluidity for neutron, etc. So the whole composition is unclear. So this is reflected in what people call the equation of state of that object. And you can consider that as the pressure as function of energy density, or practically you can think about that as the mass as function of radius of that object. So how is that related? And there are many predictions, many descriptions on the market. From our data, we get some information on that. We need much better sensitivity at higher frequencies to get more precise data. And so we have some preference for a soft equation of state. So the idea that you have these objects, these two neutron stars, that when they get close, they start doing tidal interactions, and these tidal interactions get imprinted on the gravitational wave form. The problem is that the tidal deformations only show up at fifth order in PN, so it's very difficult to extract. If you look at the signal up to something like 900 hertz, you would not see a difference if you would describe it by two point objects or whether you would take tidal interactions into account. It's only at higher frequencies that you start seeing that. As I said, we favor a soft equation of state and more compact systems. So this is what one event. If we would have something like maybe 30 to 50 events, then we really could combine the information of multiple events and say something about the equation of state. Now, this is another plot where I show you the tidal deformabilities. We get evidence for that, but it's and here is the evidence for the radius and the mass of these systems. On this binary neutron star, you have to realize a couple of things. First of all, for gravitational waves, this was the loudest event that we have detected so far, signal of a noise of more than 32. For GRBs, on the other hand, it is by far the weakest signal. It's over here. This is the luminosity. It's also the signal which is closest by. So in terms of redshift, it is here. So it's essentially zero. If you look at the sensitivity curve of Fermi that is shown over here, so if it would have been a little bit further away, Fermi would not have seen it. The other thing is that with Fermi, you get this trigger. We have no idea what the distance is. So if you get something very weak, naturally you would think it's probably very far away. But according to gravitational waves, we know the distance, and we also released the distance and was close by. And the reason for all of that is was that the cone was about 30 degrees off axis. So it was not in the line of sight of the cone of gamma rays. Okay. So here you see measurements of the spectrum. So it's rapidly decaying. You see the object over here. It starts in the blue, and then it's here. It starts in the blue and becomes red. And so then there were all these statements, so that everything that you see in yellow over here is created in these kind of collisions. So we are not stardust. We have binary neutron stardust to some extent. So that is, and of course, then a lot of discussions were about gold. We have no evidence about gold. What we have here is if we take, for example, that kilonova, and you say it is a hot region of about 6,000 Kelvin, it has black body radiation. You put some elements in there that give you absorption lines. The material is thrown out at about 20% of the speed of light, so everything is tremendously Doppler broadened, and you get these broad structures over here. So that is the evidence that you get. And so it's not so that you can see the spectral lines of single elements. That is not the case. And here again, a plot to show you the involvement of all the observatories worldwide. We managed to write a publication with most of the astronomers. I think a big fraction of all the astronomers worldwide was also a very interesting experience. So now we're waiting for the second one. So in the run that we started in April, we already had a candidate for binary neutron stars and also for binary neutron star black hole that we released. So we released the information about the candidates, but so far astronomers did not succeed in finding the counterparts. So then last word about cosmology. And typically when you do cosmology, you need to know the distance and you need to know the redshift and you can start making a cosmographic map. Problem is, or maybe not, it's the calibrations of the distance ladder and all of that. And the nice thing about gravitational waves is that the probe does not rely on this distance calibration, because in a sense, gravitational waves are self-calibrating. Immediately from the amplitude and the frequency content, you know the distance. So we use that in this event to say something about the Hubble parameter. And you know that there is the prediction of the result from Planck. There is also a result from the supernovae, and they are apart by about 8%. And you see that the result from gravitational waves here is exactly in the middle, but it has a big uncertainty. And this uncertainty is because we only have one event, so we need many more events. So here you see an estimate that we have if we would be able to combine, let's say, 50 of these events, but which will happen at some point, the question is when, that we should get in the order of 1 to 2% accuracy on that number. If we go to future instruments, then we can go much further than that. We also can, for example, measure the equation of state parameter of dark energy. We can measure the Z dependence of that. So, but with initial, say, LIGO and Virgo, this is one of the goals that we would like to do in the next few years. So this is then a summary of what I think is the scientific impact. But my apologies, I didn't say anything about astrophysics. I didn't cover anything on astronomy, because I just picked out some things that I enjoy talking about. And that is shown here. But there are many more things. I think I'll take the risk for another 7 minutes and then I stop. So on instrumentation, because you have seen all these results, but how do we do this? Because essentially what you have to do is measure these kind of displacements, and how do you measure these displacements? And you have to do it fast on a time scale of milliseconds. And is that possible? The first time I saw that, I just didn't believe that you could do that. But that's the same feeling I had with LHCb, with the trigger of LHCb. So I also thought that you couldn't do that. But it turns out that it's possible. Here is a simple Michelson interferometer, so a laser, a beam splitter, two mirrors, equal arms, and a photodetector over here. You put in light from your laser, and then 50% of the light will go on this arm, and other 50% there. It will recombine at this port here, so you look at the difference, and you will get a phase. There will be a phase development when the light travels through these arms. So this is the output that you can detect over here, dependent on the phase difference. So you can write this in this way. And then you can calculate the power by squaring this electric field. And then you get this expression over here. And that looks like this. So you shine a laser in this interferometer. You can be either on a dark fringe, or you can be on a dark fringe here, or on a bright fringe. And so here you see the phase difference. And what you would like to do is make a very, very precise measurement of the phase. So that is what your goal is. So where would you do the measurement? Yeah, on the larger slope is exactly what you would think, and that is not what we do. You cannot do that. So we are very close to the dark fringe, and that is where we do the measurement. And it has to do that if you would do that at that spot, you would have so many amplitude variations in the intensity of your laser that would come through that would destroy your measurement, would inhibit you. And I will show you later that it's better to do it here. So Michelson himself was able in about 100 years ago to measure a fringe to a precision of 1/20th of a fringe. So if you put that in there, then you can see what strain you can measure. So he has a device of, let's say, 1-2 meters, and he folds the beam a few times. So let's take a length of 10 meters, and you measure to a precision of a micron divided by 20. So your delta L over L is then in the order of 10 minus 9. What we want to measure is 10 minus 22, at least. Okay. So you see the difficulty already coming in. You have to measure very, very precisely where you are on the fringe. Another way to look at that is imagine that you put a single photon in this device, and the photon is going, and you would like to know, am I on a dark fringe or on a bright fringe? And you count the photon here, and if you see the photon, then you are on a bright fringe. If you don't see it, you are on a dark fringe. Now, if you do that, then your precision would be half a wavelength, difference between bright and dark. So that is half a micron divided by the optical length. And for LIGO, that is 4 kilometers. So you would be able to measure with an accuracy of 10 minus 10 a strain. So if you want to do 10 minus 22, you have to do 12 orders of magnitude better. So you have to repeat this experiment 10 to the power 24 times. Or put in so many more photons. You can do that too. So you put in 10 to the power 24 photons, but then you have to do the measurement in a millisecond time scale, let's say 10 milliseconds, and that means that you have to inject 20 megawatts into the interferometer. I wish you good luck, but that is not what we do. We typically in Virgo use 18 watts of input power to do the same thing. So you have to use a couple of tricks, and I would like to go through them. So first of all, you have to make your test masses free falling, because if you look at the floor here, this will vibrate somewhere between a nanometer to a micron. This floor, I think maybe, what is it, 10 to 100 nanometer per root hertz. And that is like 15 orders too high compared to the measurement that you want to do. So you have to isolate from the floor. Now, so you want to make something that looks like a free-falling mirror, but of course you cannot drop it. But you can achieve that by hanging it as a pendulum. So that's why we use the mirrors and hang them on wires. And then you can write down the equation for motion of a pendulum. So the acceleration and damping, etc. And you go to the frequency domain. So every time you see two dots, you get an omega square, an omega, etc. And you can write the displacement of the mirror as function of the displacement here from where it's hanging, which is typically connected to the ground. And so that gives you the transfer function. So the transfer function looks like this. It's one. Then there is a resonance, where the mirror is having its resonance frequency. And then you see if the motion is damped. So think about it. I take the mirror, I have it on a wire, and if I hit it, it will start oscillating on a resonance frequency. If I slowly move it with a frequency which is much smaller than the resonance frequency, the mirror will just follow. So the transfer function is one. That's what you see here. If I go way faster than the resonance frequency, the mirror cannot follow due to inertia. And that is why you get this drop off here. So you get this term at high frequency, which essentially goes with the movement that I'm moving the system with. And so that is damped coming here. It's a second order filter. And but for the forces, it just will react to forces that you put on the mirror. And this, if you go to high enough frequency, you can make it negligible. And in that sense, for these high frequencies, the mirror is like a free-falling object. It's free. It's only reacting with inertia. So that is what we use. The other thing is that I gave you that expression over here. But of course, if I go to very high frequency, then the wavelength of the gravitational waves is becoming shorter and shorter. So if the wavelength is, if the frequency is too high, then the wavelength of the gravitational wave that is coming in is so short that I start averaging out the signal in my interferometer. So that is why at high, so for an interferometer that's 4 kilometers long, if the frequencies are like, say, 50 kilohertz or higher, you cannot even measure at certain frequencies. And if you make the thing 75 kilometers already at lower frequencies, you cannot measure due to the averaging effect. So the gravitational wave is being averaged out in your sensor. So only below, it's that. So that is another effect that is hampering you. So this is typically a Michelson interferometer. Then what Ron Draver, who was a professor in Glasgow, and then went to Caltech to work on that, what he invented is make a cavity here, and then essentially your arms become much longer. So make cavities to store the light. And you can go through that calculation if you like it. Essentially, you can store lots of power in that cavity. And a cavity has a certain finesse, and the number of bounces in the cavity is increasing your phase sensitivity to the signal. So that's another thing that we do. So if we have a simple Michelson, this is our phase sensitivity. But if we make a cavity with a finesse of 440, typical numbers that we use, then you see we get much more sensitive. So that is another. So like you have an interferometer which is like hundreds of kilometers long, but you just make cavities. Then, if you measure close to a dark fringe, then energy conservation tells you that all the light will go back to the laser. So that is a pity, then it's lost. So you might as well put a mirror here and reflect it back in the interferometer. That is called power recycling. That is another invention by Ron Draver to do that. So he creates like a triangular cavity over here. You don't need a mirror here because you're on a dark fringe anyway, so nothing is coming here. So this is like a triangular cavity. And that works. Both LIGO and Virgo are doing that. And then Meers came with putting also a mirror here to recycle the signal. So when you get a signal, so gravitational wave comes in, a signal comes out over here, then you might as well reflect the signal back. And then that whole system will act like an optical spring and will amplify your signal in a certain frequency range. So this is already installed in LIGO, and it's giving them 3-4 times better sensitivity at high frequencies than we have at Virgo, because we don't have that yet. There's a complication in getting stability on the interferometer, so we will do this next year. So then the whole interferometer that we use is a so-called dual recycling Fabry-Pérot interferometer. And then we also have some input mode cleaners to clean up this, say, remove all the higher modes that are injected into the system, and also remove all the unwanted modes before we detect, so we detect a pure clean signal on our photo detectors. So I think I'll leave it at this for the moment. Thanks.
Great, thanks a lot. So let's try and have a few questions. Does anyone have any questions, comments?
Is there a way we can learn about the charge of black holes?
Yeah, and when you have the when they are charged, then the solution should not be the Kerr solution, but it should be different. Now, I don't have right now a quantitative answer to that, so I don't know how much these solutions would differ. I think the general feeling that people have right now is that astrophysical objects should not have charge. But as a physicist, you're completely right. So, but I cannot answer what the difference is between Kerr metric and I forgot the name with the charged metric. Yeah.
Sorry, I wanted just to ask you, because you said correctly that you have six polarizations, right? Mm-hmm. If you take non-Einsteinian theories of gravity. Yeah. And then, you know, first question would be, when you say that they are gravitational waves, could you imagine, of course the orientation matters, as you said, you know, yeah, in the arms of the interferometers, but the question could be, you cannot probably imagine a situation where two vectors combine to give you a signal similar to the one of a tensor at this stage, because, you know, if, of course, as you said, you know, if you have 4, 5, 6 interferometers together in a network, you'll be able to pick all the polarizations. But at this stage, you know, when you sort of claim that these were gravitational waves coming from a black hole, I'm not saying this is not true, but I'm just saying that could you imagine two vectors faking your signal in such a way that you get a similar signal to the one you would get from tensors.
Yeah, I think there was a publication on that topic in the past where people assumed some funny interactions that could rotate polarizations, but then you assumptions go far beyond, say, straightforward assumptions. So then you think about different fields in interacting, changing, rotating polarizations. I think the answer at the end, so with the two different orientations that we have right now, and the fact that you have six polarizations, obviously we cannot decompose. So that is given. Then one of the polarizations, one of the scalar ones, you just cannot measure with interferometers. So also that will never be accessible. So what the end, what the precision will be, it also depends a bit how precise you can point, because that gives you the uncertainty and the antenna pattern. And I think it will. So maybe a better way to get to answer these questions would not be using the binary coalescence, but if we could find, for example, a deformed neutron star which continuously is emitting gravitational waves, and you're rotating on Earth with respect to it, I think then you could start disentangling with all these different detectors what the polarization content is.
So if you have long signal as opposed to short.
Yeah, if you would have a continuous wave signal. So we are looking for that. We have an analysis group devoted to that, but so far we didn't see anything yet. So there we are trying to get sensitivities of 10 to the minus 25, 26, and delta L over L, but by integrating signals over a long time.
So first of all, both the lectures and the physics are fantastic, so thank you. I have a question about the frequency of these events, right? You said what you expected personally was the first event being a neutron star merger rather than a black hole merger. What did we learn so far on sort of the formation of the universe, and how many of these events do we expect, in which magnitude, and sort of that aspect? Which
yeah, if you would translate this to population models, and I didn't talk about that at all, then I think you would estimate that every few minutes somewhere in the universe, one of these events is taking place. So that is. But then there are many things that at least excite me. But we have to be further. We have to get more evidence to show that. So I find it surprising, for example, that the spins are close to zero. And also this population was not predicted on the basis of astronomical observations. And there were some theorists that indeed said maybe there are these heavier systems, but not based, for example, on X-ray binaries. That was not predicted. So one possibility might be that they are primordial. So that is, there are many publications on that one. So that, for example, at the time of the QCD phase transition, so if you have a fluctuation in this primordial plasm, then if there is an overdensity, it can collapse. But of course, you get counter, you get heating and counter pressure. But at the phase transition, that drops and you could collapse. If you do that for the QCD phase transition, you get solar mass type of black holes that are coming out. And then the probability can be very small, maybe 1 in 10 to the 9th or 1 in 10 to the 10th. But that is then matter content that you have. And the time evolution is different than the radiation. So you get about a redshift advantage of 9 orders of magnitude that it will be amplified in content today. So I think there is no reason now to assume that if that is the process, that you will get a lot of spin, because it's a direct collapse. So this is exciting many people. There are arguments, is this not excluded because of lensing? And then the counter arguments are, yeah, but that depends on what, where are they? Are they in globular clusters or in satellite galaxies? Or if they are uniformly distributed, then they would not be possible. So that is something I think is quite exciting. Some people think that could be part of the dark matter. So that is one part of the story, but there are many of these possibilities. So.
But would you say that most people involved in these experiments were surprised by the frequency of these big events that you were seeing, or is this
Sure. That is, I think, quite a lot that we see this now. So even after the first run, so when we did the predictions for the for our event rates. So when we started doing the measurement in 2015, then the uncertainty in event rate, so what we would see, were three orders of magnitude for binary neutron stars, where we already know the populations. For binary black holes, was even way higher. So still right now, the predictions are quite uncertain. What we see at the moment is that we are repeatedly, we see every week or sometimes twice a day, we see binary black hole collisions. So they are now, we know that they're a bit on the high side compared to what we thought. And then neutron stars, we have now two events where we are with very high probability sending out the candidate information that we believe it's 99% certain that it contains a neutron star. And then there are more events where it's mixed, maybe 50% or something like that. So all of that is reasonably on the high side. Yeah. So that's also then nice if you think about future detectors. So the thing that we keep talking about is the Einstein telescope, is to go in that direction. So then you would be compared to the design sensitivity. We don't have the design sensitivity yet. We would be in order of magnitude more precise. More sensitive. So that means that compared to design value, we get 1,000 times the rate. So in a couple of years, you have like a million of these events. And so that is at the end. And we gain rapidly because we measure an amplitude. So it's within no time, you are on your own, more or less, doing these measurements.
Is there any last question? One more.
Thank you very much for the fantastic speech. So I'm just wondering, so far we just talk about the binary body. So I'm wondering, so of course, there may be a chance, maybe a very tiny chance that three bodies, like three black holes or three nuclear stars, they would merge, and then there will be somehow different polarizations or something. Okay, I'm just wondering if there's a theory to predict such kind of more complex process, and also, let's say, our experiment would be considered to improve to have such kind of, you know, detection to have this to have this kind of complex detection.
Yeah. So.
Thank you.
Yeah. So the two of the analyses that we're doing, so one is called CBC, so there's coalescence of compact binary coalescence, and the other one is burst. So if you think that you know precisely the shapes of the waveforms, then you can make template banks, you can calibrate them to your numerical relativity calculations, you can start looking for these events. So that is one approach, and we restrict that right now to these events that we talk about. So these are binary events. But there is another analysis that doesn't care about the shape. So your would be in that class of events, most probably. And the same holds for a supernova. Can you imagine that if a supernova would go off right now with all these detectors on, not this month, because we are off this month, but in general, that would be fantastic. But you don't know what the shape of the signal is. So the burst group just look at coherence between that and then picks it out. And then you would start comparing to your predictions and maybe post-predictions at that point. It's a general difficulty. So when I also showed you the test of general relativity, then it was a test, so you pose, is it consistent with general relativity or not? I don't give you different alternatives, because then the different alternatives would have to be worked out at the level as general relativity is worked out, would have to provide you all of that information and template banks, and then we can start looking for that. And not many alternatives are at the level of GR.
Okay, so let's thank speaker again, and we have the last lecture tomorrow.